In this session, now we are going to discuss about the employee participation in safety as a topic under industrial safety management. Now, as we know that safety is one of the major concern in the industries, and that is why we are calling it as industrial safety. So to manage this industrial safety, the participation of worker, participation of the employees, participation of the managerial or higher level authorities, all the elements of the organization should be involved in the industrial safety. So for that purpose, this employee participation is a major element. What are the contents of this presentation is? The purpose of employee participation in safety, then areas of participation, methods of participation, workers and union participation, safety suggestion scheme, safety incentive schemes, audio visual publicity, authors promotional methods, safety committee, toolbox talk, safety kaizen, 1 point lesson, safety competition, safety awards at national, state and unit level. So we must discuss all these points one by one. So what exactly the purpose of this employee participation in safety is? So the major workforce working under the hazards. So in each and every industry, the industry may be of chemical industry, that may be engineering industry, that may be a different type of industry. So whatever the industrial type is there, but hazards are present in every industry. So the hazard may be a physical hazard, there may be a mechanical hazard, maybe fire hazard, maybe chemical hazard, maybe ergonomical hazards, whatever it may be. So irrelevant of the type of hazard and the severity of that hazard, that may be a low level, moderate level or high level hazards, but to reduce this hazard, to eliminate this hazard, we have to do some tasks. So one of the points which we have discussed in the earlier session is training. Now, apart from that training, we have to participate in some of the activities which are related to safety to reduce this type of hazards. So some employees are knowing the hazards very well. Some employees are not knowing the hazards. Some employees are knowing the hazards, but not following the safety instruction accordingly, and that is the main reason where the chances of accident or incidents are there. So it is great importance that must be realized that first victim of any accident, their safety awareness and all accident prevention work is their interest, and that is active participation in showing hazards and helping in removing them by joint efforts by management and all employees most desirable. So this is the joint activity. It is not the activity of any one person or only of safety officer or only safety head, etc. It is the joint activity. It is the responsibility of each and every person in the organization, and that is why here it is clearly mentioned that it is a joint efforts by the management and all the employees. Because management is permitting us to do these type of safety activities to encourage and motivate the participation of all the employees in these type of activities, and employees are the main key elements who are going to participate in these activities, and learning is continual on the basis of these activities, right? So it is a joint effort. So the legal reference for this employee participation in safety is section 41G of the Factory Act, which clearly indicates that the workers' participation in safety management is essential, right? So we will take a look on this legal requirement as well as the state level rules also. Then in general, when the employee participation is there, it communicates workplace safety issues. So we all know that employee participation may be in a batch form in a department level, at a organizational level, or at some other levels also. So that may be a district level activity, that may be a state level activity, that may be a national level activity also. So the employees of the same organization or the different organization can take parts in that particular activity, and in this way we can communicate this workplace safety issues to that particular persons. Provide relevant safety informations. So whatever the good practices, whatever the safe practices which are running in your organizations should be shared to the other people. If one of the department is having good safety practices, then that should be shared to the other department. If the good safety practices in one organization may share to the other organization, and likewise. So that safety information should be shared to the employees of same or different organizations. Know how to report accidents and hazards. So this is again a legal requirement, or maybe not legal requirement. So if the accident is of reportable type, then you should go for the reportable accident formats and all the activities within 48 hours, because if the employee is not reporting to the job before 48 hours, or if the fatality is there, or if the major accident is there, then all these types of accidents are reportable one. So you have to report all the details of the accidents to the factory inspector or to the Department of Industrial Safety and Health Office, and to other concerns also. So what exactly the reportable format is there, what are the contents of that accidents or the hazards are there. If you are going to increase the capacity, tonnage capacity, or the storage capacity of any type of hazardous chemicals which is listed in MSIS 1989, then also you have to report all these changes to the factory inspector or the DISH department, right? So you should know all these activities, because our main aim is to reduce the hazard, our main aim is to reduce the accident, to avoid the repetition of these accidents. Then contribute to and be involved in your school distribute safety programs, etc. So some of the district collector's office, some of the district emergencies offices are conducting this type of programs for the school students, for the college students, for the fresher students, etc. So your organization also contribute to these types of programs to aware these safety related things, like that may be a hazards or then types and then examples, then that may be accidents, that may be emergency declaration, or what should do if the fire catches, what should do if the natural disaster is happen, etc. So your organization, your employee participation representation is essential in this type of programs. What are the areas of this participation? So the general areas of the participation are to set safety goals and training programs. So you have to set the safety goals and training programs for the participation. So in the previous session we have already discussed about what exactly the training is, what is the need of training, how to identify the need of these programs, then how, what are the objectives and goals of the training should be, then whether the training should be conducted in a formal approach, in an informal approach, in the on the job training, that is off the job training, whatever it may be. So all these things should be taken into account while setting these safety goals. And then if you are ready to go for this training, if you are ready to conduct this training, if you are ready to train the trainees also, means acts as a trainer. So whatever may be the role, that may be from the training point of view, that may be from the trainer point of view, that may be from the motivation or encourage point of view, whatever it may be, but your participation is very essential, very important in that particular organization to design and improve standard operating procedures. So this standard operating procedure is not a new task. It is already SOPs are designed by the organization, designed by that particular department or section or a particular operators and engineers also. So these SOPs are already available in the organization, but improvement, updation, upgradation is necessary. So if your organization is not having these SOP, then you have to design it. But if you have already these SOPs, then you have to improve these SOPs and the method of operations. Because in some of the machineries, in some of the techniques, in some of the processes, some modifications, some changes may be there as per our need, as per our expansion of the industries, as per our change in the product, change in the quality of the product. So if any process step or if any point, any raw material, that may be parameters like temperature, pressure, flow meter, etc., is changed, then you have to improve your SOP accordingly. Suppose if the temperature is going to change, then the standard operating procedure may be changed a little bit. But you should know what exactly the change is and what is the latest or new SOP is there. Then your participation is also must. So you have to take part in the discussion. You have to take part in the designing and improve these SOPs as an expertise, because the operators, the workers who are actually doing the operations on that particular machinery in that process, they are the main experts. They are the main knowledgeable and experienced persons who can share their views in the designing of and improving the SOPs. Then appraisal of progress towards the goals. So whatever the goals which is decided by your organization should be achieved, and on the basis of that goals, you have to do some participation. That may be from the environment point of view, that may be from energy point of view, that may be from safety point of view, that may be from the production point of view, that may be from HR point of view. So there are various aspects and elements which are involved in the organizations. So as per your expertise, as per your need, as per your updation, you have to participate in these types of activity to achieve this type of goal, which is already decided by the organization and the management. To give, collect, discuss safety suggestions and to implement which are necessary. Now in some of the cases, if you are having only production activity, but it doesn't mean that you can't observe the things which is available or which are already running in your organization other than the production department. You can give the suggestions to other departments also. You can give the suggestions to your subordinates also. You can collect the information from other companies also who are going in a very good safety positions. Then you can discuss the things with the subordinates, with the seniors, with the worker helper also, that this is the good suggestions, this is the suggestions which is valid and can be implemented in the particular process. So whatever the discussion, whatever the information collection, whatever the suggestions given by you is nothing but the participation in that safety activity. Then when workers are taken into confidence in designing any safety program or goal, they feel themselves responsible for its success. So normally when we are doing the activities in a formal way, then the workers are only in a listening mode. Normally the workers are only receiving the things, only learning the things at that moment only. But when the management giving you the responsibilities that you have to design the safety programs, you are the responsible for designing this safety program, to conduct this safety program, to run this safety programs and to success this safety program, then the responsibilities for its success is on the worker side, on the employee side, and then you may go through the detail for this conduction and success of these programs. Then you can think of at the micro level, nano level activities of the safety, which is not the case when you are in the listening mode only. So these are the different areas where you can participate in the safety programs. That may be in terms of training, that may be in terms of some SOPs design or improvement, that may be in terms of achieving the goal activities, that may be in terms of giving or collection or discussing the information related to the safety, and that may be responsibility of designing the safety programs and conduction of the safety programs. So these are the different areas. Then methods of participation. So one of the main methods of participation that is a safety committee. So this safety committee may be of different types, because normally in the industries the safety committees are formed, but the committee may be exploitative authoritative type, that may be a benevolent authoritative type, that may be a consultative, and that may be a participative. So depending on the type of organization, depending on the management views, the committee may be of that particular type. So suppose if some exploitative, benevolent or consultative type of active committees are there, then there are some loopholes in that particular committee, because when we are using the dictator type committees, then there is only top to bottom communication, top to bottom orders, and in some of the cases if you are giving the freedom to the employees, then also there may be a misguidance, there may be a problem where some of the employees are not going to participate in the safety programs. And when some of the consultant or the third person is going to say that you should go through this training, you should go through this program where the safety participation is there, then that activity may be run in that particular time or that particular period or duration only. But when it is a participative nature, then it is a useful one as compared to other three type of safety committees. So this last approach of participative concept is adopted by many countries, and joint efforts of workers have resulted in the reducing the accidents. So when the worker or the employee itself participating in the safety programs, in the safety activities, in the safety supervisions or other competitions which are related to the safety, then the accidents are obviously reduced in, that may be in number, that may be in the severity. So the fourth part or the fourth type of safety committee is nowadays a common. Now what exactly this safety committee is? So this is a legal requirement as far as the Factory Act is concerned. So with reference to the section 41 and section 41G, Factory Act 1948 requires constitution of the safety committee in the factories meeting, the following criteria should be. So this is the legal requirement where this is the criteria. So what exactly this criteria is? If the unit employing 250 or more workers are there. So if an organization employing 250 or more workers, then the safety committee is essential or mandatory. If the units cover under the section 87 of the Factory Act 1948 and employing more than 50 workers, it means normally when your unit is having some dangerous operations or the hazardous substances are involved, that may be a raw material, that may be a process, that may be a final product, whatever it may be. So if the hazardous substances, hazardous chemicals and dangerous operations are carried out in your industry, then even if the workers are 50 or more than 50, then also the safety committee is an essential requirement. Then units cover under section 2CB, that is hazardous substances of the Factory Act 1948, and employing more than 50 workers. So already discussed this, dangerous operations and hazardous substances are involved, Then 50 plus workers organizations is having the requirement that safety committee should be formed as per as the section 41 and 41G is concerned. And for other organization, 250 plus worker is the essential condition. Now, as far as this Maharashtra factory rule 1963 is concerned, under the rule number 73J, that is with reference to that 41G of Factory Act, this 73J is formed. So Factory Act is always gives us the guidelines at the national level, and when we are discussing about the rules, it means that is the state rule. So for this case, it is a Maharashtra state, and for the Maharashtra state, it is Maharashtra Factory Rule 1963. So under this MFR 1963, rule number 73J, focusing on the safety committee. So these are the details which are already covered under this rule. In every factory where 250 or more workers are ordinarily employed, or which carries any process or operation declared to be dangerous under section 87 of the Act, and employs more than 50 workers, C, which carries an hazardous process as defined under section 2CB of this Act, employs more than 50 workers, there shall be a safety committee. So this condition is the same condition which is already discussed under the section 41G of the Factory Act 1948. So the same point is covered under this 73J of MFR 1963. Second point is the representatives of this management on safety committee shall include. Now this sub-rule 2 gives us the idea what exactly the safety committee is, or what is the structure of the safety committee should be. So this safety committee is essential for the organization where a hazardous process or dangerous operations are there, and 50 plus workers are available. And for non-dangerous operations and non-hazardous processes, if 250 plus workers are there, then safety committee should be formed. So what is the content, or what is the structure of this safety committee? Is a senior official who by his position in the organization can contribute effectively to the functioning of this committee shall be the chairman. So this safety committee should contain this senior official as a chairman. Then second, a safety officer and factory medical officer wherever available, and a safety officer in such case shall be the secretary of the committee. So wherever the safety officer is essential, wherever the factory medical officers are there, then this safety officer and factory medical officer is a part of this safety committee, and safety officer will be the secretary of this safety committee. Now this safety officer wording is nothing but the qualified safety officer, that is the requirement as per the Factory Act 1948 as per the section 40B. So minimum degree qualification, that is engineering or BE or MSc, plus 2 years experience, plus industrial safety course, or diploma engineer, or BSc plus 5 years experience plus industrial safety course. And if that condition, that eligibility is satisfied, then we can call it as qualified safety officer as per this section 40B of Factory Act 1948. So if the safety officer is available in your industry due to dangerous operation, that may be due to hazardous process, that may be due to the employee's number. So if it is an essential condition, then obviously this safety officer acts as a secretary of this safety committee. Then a representative each from the production, maintenance and purchase department is essential. So normally the production manager, maintenance manager and purchase manager are the representatives which are the parts or the member of this safety committees. So this is the essential structure of this safety committee. So you can add the other members from the other departments manager or from other departments a senior or workers or union representatives, etc. So this is the third point. The workers representative on this committee shall be elected by the workers. So workers representative, that is nothing but the workers participation in the safety committee is the main safety participation activity. So where the safety committee is having a chairman as a senior official, then safety officer, factory medical officer, other managers from the production, maintenance, purchase department or other department, then in that meeting, in that committee, this workers representative is also representing the workers. So you can give the suggestions, you can give some information, you can collect the information, you can understand the updates of our industry from the safety point of view. All these things are nothing but the participation of the workers representative in the safety. The tenure of this committee shall be of 2 years. So as far as the 73J of MFR 1963 is concerned, the tenure is normally of 2 years. So this safety committee shall meet as often as necessary, but at least once in every quarter. So this is essential and legal requirement that the safety committee shall conduct a meeting at least once in a every quarter. The minutes of the meeting shall be recorded and produced to the inspector on demand. So whatever the minutes of meetings, whatever the points are discussed in that particular meeting, what are the points discussed in the previous meetings, then overview of that points and the minutes of the current meeting, etc. So whatever the suggestions, whatever the certifications, whatever the programs, whatever the supervisions, observations, etc., all the points related to the safety can be the part or the minutes of this safety committee meetings. So all these minutes can be recorded and produced to the inspector on demand. So this is the part of 73J, safety committee of MFR 1963. Now we have already discussed about this point, because these are the general points and whatever we have discussed in the previous slide are the legal requirement for the Maharashtra state government. Maharashtra state government gives us the Maharashtra Factory Rule 1963 and under the section 41G of Factory Act and under the rule of 73J of MFR 1963. These are the guidelines and now near about same guidelines are covered under this slide. So the formation, tenure and the rights of this safety committee, a senior official shall be the chairman, the same thing as discussed in the 73J. A safety officer or factory medical officer shall be secretary. Same thing, a representative each from the production, maintenance, purchase department shall be the members. Workers representative of equal number shall be elected by the workers. The tenure of the committee shall be 2 years, at least one meeting in 3 months. Minutes shall be recorded and produced before the factory inspector on demand. And the committee has right to be informed of potential hazards of workplaces and data on accident and working environment. The committee shall keep the data confidential and use it solely to guide on safety measures. So these are the same or similar guidelines for other industries, for other state also, because it is near about same as per the 73J and section 41G of the Factory Act, right? So the committee, safety committee members are having these rights to inform the potential hazards. Suppose your plant is changing the raw material from LPG to LNG, then whatever the hazards, whatever the storage capacity, whatever the hazard present related to that CNG as compared to LPG should be informed to the factory inspector. If you are changing the process, that may be from the manual to semi-automatic or from semi-automatic to automatic, or if you are changing the capacity of the boiler, capacity of the furnace, capacity of the storage tank, etc., then you have to check, identify the potential hazards and he can inform this potential hazards to the factory inspector, right? And in the similar way, you can give the data regarding the accident, incidents, or tier list to the factory inspector. Then what are the functions and the duties of these safety committee members? Cooperation to implement health and safety policy. So this is the main function, the cooperation to implement this policy. So this health and safety policy is again essential or mandatory condition as per as this Maharashtra Factory Rule 1963 is concerned. So in the Maharashtra Factory Rule 1963, it is given that you have to develop the health and safety policy. That may be rule number 73L. So as per as this rule, you have to develop the health and safety policy. So whatever the points, whatever the elements which are involved under this health and safety policy, you have to implement these points to run the organization, to conduct all the activities in your organization, and for that purpose you have to cooperate with all the department, to cooperate with all the employees as per as the safety committee is concerned. So if someone is suggesting some task, some change, some valid suggestions, then you have to think of on that particular suggestions, and if the suggestion is valid, then you have to implement that suggestion in that particular field, in that particular operations. So that is nothing but the cooperation. All matters of health, safety, and environment, and solutions to problem in that regard. So if some department is facing some problem that may be related to the environment, like that may be related to the water, that may be related to the air, that may be related to the some pollutants which are producing in a specific activity or in a routine activity, then that should be resolved with the help of these safety committee members, because in the safety committee members there are different representatives and expert persons are available. So that case may be with reference to the working in a safety manner. That may be a safety operating procedure, that may be a work permit systems, that may be a confined spaces activities, that may be some issues related to the personal property equipment, that may be issues related to the some accident or incident happen in the industries, and that may be issues related to your health. So in some of the department, in some of the cases, in some of the laboratory testing processes, etc., so some hazards may be present. So if the health hazard is there, if some safety hazards are there, in some environmental hazards are there, then you have to think of all these types of hazard, and you have to, it's your responsibility, that is the responsibility of safety committee, to give the solution on that particular type of problem. Then the creation of safety awareness among workers. So for the safety culture of your organization, you have to take care of the awareness programs, awareness among the workers. So awareness may be in terms of some training programs, maybe in some routine activities, maybe through the some displays, that may be a posters, that may be a signages, that may be a digital displays, that may be a pledge, that may be some competitions, that may be some video or films, etc. So all these things can combine together to create the awareness about the safety. So that is the responsibility of the safety committee, to conduct educational training promotional activities on safety, health and environmental surveys, safety audits, risk, etc. So whatever the hazards involved in your daily activity, in your department, in your unit, whatever the risk involved in your activities or in the department and in the organization, that should be taken care of by this safety committee persons, and that should be informed or communicated to that particular person also. then for that purpose you can go through this surveys. That may be a safety survey, health survey, environmental surveys. That may be some safety audits like internal audit or external audit, and there may be some promotional activities like educational activities, some training program, etc. So all these activities again can create the safety awareness among the workers. To discuss report, assessment, emergency plans and implementation of the recommendations of these reports. So if internal auditor or external auditor, safety auditor, environmental auditor, or some factory medical officer or some safety officer, whatever the person is, the responsible person or the audit team is giving you some of the points, then you have to discuss that points among the workers, then in the safety committee meetings, then you have to plan for that particular point. So that plan may be an emergency plan, that may be an on-site plan, that may be an off-site plan, that may be a specific plans for a specific activity, and implementation of all these recommendations that may be given by these committee members, that may be given by the workers or the employees. If all these recommendations are valid, then you have to discuss all these recommendations in the organization, and it should be recorded in the reports. To carry out health and safety surveys, identify causes of accidents. So this is one of the major activity to perform by the safety committee members, because the main target of any type of organization is nothing but the zero accidents. To achieve that goal, you have to reduce the number of accidents, you have to reduce the severity of this accident, and for that purpose you have to identify the causes of accidents. So you should study the similar types of accident, you should refer the reports of similar types of this accident, and then you should go through the different types of accident reporting and investigation processes to identify the causes of accidents. So this is the responsibility of safety committee. To look into complaints of imminent danger and suggest corrective measures. Now, this is one of the point again where the safety committee should be look into the matter, because some of the chemicals are very hazardous, some of the chemicals are explosive nature, then that may be a highly inflammable or inflammable nature, then some of the operations are very dangerous, some of the operation may be having some risk, that may be a health risk, that may be some physical risk, etc. So whatever the danger involved in that particular activity, that should be noted down, and depending on that activity, depending on the danger situation, you have to suggest the corrective measures before starting this actual activity. Then to review the implementation of its own recommendations. So whatever the suggestions or the corrective measures you have suggested for these dangerous activities, for this type of operations, you have to review yourself. So if you suggest something, how to tackle the hazardous substance, or how to use this self-contained breathing apparatus in these confined spaces, how to use the anti-static tools in the highly inflammable areas, etc. So depending on your suggestions, you can again ask the workers, you can ask the supervisors or the other employees whether these suggestions are good or not. So depending on their feedback, depending on their review, again you can go for the improvement or the corrections in the suggestions. Then to form subcommittees if necessary. If your organization is a big organization in the number, if your organizations are having more dangerous operations, your organization is having more hazardous substances to be handled, or the quantity of hazardous substance is more, then you have to form subcommittees to control all these types of activity, to control all these workers or the employees. So depending on the need of the organization, you can decide whether the subcommittees are required or not. The main objective of the committee is to advise the managing director and the safety board or the top executive of this company on all matters of the safety health of workers. Now, whatever you have observed, whatever you have learned, whatever the workers or the employees are suggesting you some problems, giving you some issues, discussing some issues, then that should be communicated to the management level. That should be advised to the managing director and the safety boards or the top executive of this company, because they are the facilitator. Because unless and until you have discussed these problems, that you required some PPEs, you required some engineering control techniques, you required some equipments or machinery. So for that purpose, for that facilities, the investment or the costing solutions will be given by this top management authorities only. So that should be communicated to the MD or the top executives. These are the different functions and duties of the safety committee. Now, there are different types of safety committees. That may be a main or central safety committee. That may be a plant or shop safety committee. That may be a technical safety committee. That may be a special purpose safety committee. So this is depends on the requirement of your organization. Suppose your organization is having less number of employees, having less number of dangerous operations, or you are not handling the hazardous substances, then only one committee is sufficient for that purpose. But if more plants are there, if more units are there, more sections are there, if the number of employees are more, or your shop floor activities are more, then you have to form these type of committees like shop safety committee or plant safety committees. So for that particular plant or for that particular shop, the safety committee is different. Then technical safety committee. Suppose if your organization is having purely electrical oriented activities, so electrical hazards are present, then specific technical safety committee should be formed for that particular controlling that electrical hazards. If your organization is of chemical industry, then that may be a specific technical safety committee where chemical hazards are taken care. Then in some of the organizations, special purpose safety committees are. Suppose your historical data or accident data is showing that there are many accidents in a specific area, in a specific activity, then a special purpose safety committee should be appointed to reduce this hazard, to reduce these accidents. So that totally depend on your organization's requirement. Its essential requirements are setup should be appropriate to the work, main committee to include 12 key executives, members should be well known and have respect to fellow members, member must be well aware of working conditions, work methods, practices, hazards, causes of accidents and remedial measures, and it should be as small as possible with minimum members from the sections necessary. So all these essential requirements, that normally 12 key members or key executives should be involved in that particular committee, and all must have their expertise, experience, qualifications, etc. in that particular working conditions or that work methods to reduce this hazard, to reduce this accident, to identify the causes of accidents and to give some solutions to the problems also. The policies and procedure for this committee. When a committee is formed, written instructions should be issued covering scope of activities, extent of authorities and procedure as to time, place of meeting, frequency of meeting, order of business, records to be kept and attendance requirement. So all these are nothing but the policy and procedures. So whatever the committee is formed, whatever the members are selected, so the members' name, the designation, their experience, their eligibility, their qualification, etc., all this should be in the written form, and you have to give written instruction to each and every member about their scope of activities, about their authorities and about their procedures. The management should make it clear that it wants results and should give effective executive supervision over the affairs of this committee. The committee member should have firm determination to advance the cause of safety. So the manager view, management's views is very clear that they want results, they want to reduce the accident, they want to identify the causes of accident, they want to reduce the risk in the operations, etc. So whatever the goals and objectives which are finalized by the management, and they are expecting these things from the safety committee members. The functions of main and central safety committees. So near about same functions are which we have discussed in the safety committee as per the rules, to decide safety policy and planning for purchase of equipment within built safety devices, relationship between department, standards to be followed in guarding, testing, designing, layout, housekeeping, material handling, placing, inspection, accident investigation and reports. So the health and safety policy is the legal document again, and to achieve these elements which are involved in the health and safety policy, we have to observe all these types of things like safety devices, that may be some guards. So what wherever the revolutionary machineries are there, wherever the moving machineries are there, moving parts are involved, then guarding is essential. So these guarding guarding types, all the testings of these guardings should be formed as per as the IS standards are available. Then some testing designing, layout, housekeeping, etc. So testing may be of that particular machinery, that may be of hydraulic testing, that may be of laboratory testing, that may be of some parameter testing, that may be non-destructive testing, that may be a destructive testing, whatever it may be. So all these activities should be observed carefully to avoid the incidents or accidents. The layout is the initial document where before starting the actual operation in your industry, you have to finalize this plant and layout, and that should be designed in a well manner. Generally, minimum two gates are involved. Centralized plant, plant should be, the process plant should be at the center. Then at the side, administrative building should be separated out, and storage devices or storage tanks are also, or storage farms are at the corner of one of the point. Then housekeeping should be maintained as per as this 5S level housekeeping is required, and some material handling, that material handling is again a tedious task when it is a hazardous chemicals or the substance. Then the placing of that material, so depending on the type of material, depending on the state of material, that may be solid, liquid or gases, we have to place this material in a proper way. Some inspections should be done, whether this material, whether this testing, whether this guarding, all these things are as per the standards, as per the requirements, as per the legal norms. Then some accident investigation and record should be maintained if the accident is happened. So that accident may be a reportable accident, that may be non-reportable accident, that may be a incident type, that may be a near miss type, whatever it may be. But to avoid the repetition of this accident, we have to investigate this accident and we have to maintain the records of this investigation. Then to plan and supervise programs of safety propaganda, education, training and maintaining the interest of employees in safety. So we have to plan and supervise all these types of programs to create the awareness, to create the interest in the safety area, to make arrangement or develop the safe work practices and procedures, inspection, audit, appraisal systems and all efforts to avoid or reduce the accident, to discuss and control the accident rate. So we have already discussed that our main objective or goal should be zero accidents. To achieve this goal, we can make this arrangement. to discuss and initiate actions for corrections of unsafe conditions and unsafe act. Then action plan should be drawn and suitable date fixed for completion of each task. So after inspection, after supervision, after observation of all the activities from all the department, we have to set some goal that we have to complete this task, that we have to avoid this all unsafe condition, we have to avoid this unsafe acts like that. So we have to set some target for this completion of this all these activities. So if the oil is spilled on the shop floor, that is unsafe condition. If electrical wire, that may be a leak or not leak. If electrical wire is on the shop floor, then that is again the unsafe condition. If some overhead lines are below the standard height, then that may be unsafe condition. If some insulations are damaged, that is thermal insulation, that may be a electrical insulation, then there is again unsafe condition for the temperature, as a temperature and electrical shock. Likewise, all these unsafe conditions you have to observe and we have to avoid these conditions. Then some unsafe act, that may be a normal or the power tools or the manual tools or hammer tools can be used in the highly inflammable areas, which is not permitted, so that we have to avoid these activities, or we have to use the anti-static tools in that highly inflammable areas. Then using the more than 24 volt lamps in the highly inflammable areas is another unsafe act. And likewise, we have to identify the different unsafe acts and we have to reduce these unsafe acts. That should be decided when to complete it and how to complete it. Then to suggest safety devices and protective equipment. So we have to give the suggestions on this type of activities, on these types of conditions and on these types of devices. So there are some devices, like nowadays we are using some thermal sensor devices, we are using some body sensor devices to avoid the accidents. So these type of devices should be advised to that particular department or the person. Some protective equipment guidelines should be given. Suppose for the confined spaces, we have to use the airline respirator or the oxygen cartridge or the self-contained breathing apparatus, some light provisions, etc. In some of the cases, if you are handling the chemicals like acids or acid type, then we have to use the acid proof gloves. If you are using some of the nails or the sharp edges tools, then we have to use the some of the hand gloves which are anti-puncture hand gloves. So likewise, we have to advise the personal protective equipment for a particular activity. So depending on the activity, which is the appropriate PPE is there, that should be advised to that particular person. To carry out fire drill and rehearsal of on-site emergency plan. So this is the legal activity actually. In once in a year, you have to go through this fire drill, because in case of fire, how to extinguish that fire, how to control that fire, how to handle this fire. So with the help of portable fire extinguisher, with the help of some fixed fire extinguishers, that may be a fire hydrant systems, that may be a fire hose, that may be a fire reel, that may be a fire tender, etc. So we have to handle these situations. So to carry out this fire drill, the main aim is to handle the actual fire accident or incident. And then rehearsal of this onset emergency plan. In case some emergency is taken place on the site, then how to handle this emergency situation, where to go, where not to go, where to assemble, then where from we have to take the exit, from which doors. So what is exactly the evacuation procedure is. So there are lots of things under this onset emergency plan. So this is again a mandatory or essential requirement as far as the MFR 1963 as well as MSIHC 1989 is concerned. Then to arrange safety competitions and to decide awards for the encouragement. So to motivate the workers, to encourage the workers, we should plan some, arrange some competitions, and for that competition we have to give some awards or rewards to a winner or runner. Then through these activities, through this competition, each and every worker who is going to participate in that activity, in that competition, should learn about the safety. Then the functions of plant safety committee. So depending on the requirement, we have discussed that if suppose other than the centralized or one safety committee, if the plant is required, the plant safety committee, then the functions of this plant safety committees are to review accident records. So this is the task where in that plant only whatever the accident has happened, so review about this accident, accident investigation should be done, what are the causes of accident, then how to avoid this accident in future, then what are the remedial measures for this accident, etc., all should be recorded. To investigate accidents and to implement corrective actions, so after investigations of this accident, we have to take the interview with the supervisor, interview with that person, interview with the other employees who are involved in that particular operation or the section, and then on the basis of this interview, on the basis of this investigation, we have to implement some corrective actions to avoid the accident again. To implement directives of this central safety committee, so this plant safety committee has to follow the guidelines from the central safety committee. So central safety committee is the main controlled safety committee, and this plant safety committee is designed for that particular plant only. Then enforcement of safety rules, procedures and accepted safety practices, so all these things should be followed, which are guidelines given by the central safety committees. To encourage and enforce the use of personal protective equipment, so for that particular plant, this responsibilities of this plant safety committee is that to encourage these people in that plant to use this personal protective equipment where the engineering control is not possible. Then safety inspection rounds of various shops and action sections, so you have to take the supervision, you have to take the inspection for round for the various sections and the shops. To encourage safety suggestions from workers and to forward them to the central safety committees, so you can collect the information, you can collect the suggestions from the workers from various shops or from the sections, and all these suggestions can be forwarded to the central safety committee for the implementations. So these are some of the functions of plant safety committees. Now workers and union participation is the main element as far as the safety committee is concerned. Equal number of safety representatives from workers or their union and management constitute their joint safety committee. So this is the another task where equal number of the workers representative or union representatives are there with management constituent, so that may form a safety committee. This may be a central one or different in different plants. All must be sincere in their desire to cooperate in the matter of safety. So our focus or these unions focus should be on safety only, right? It is not the case that should be focused only on the financial terminologies. It should be focused on safety, and that is why it is permitted that equal number of workers or union representative with equal number of management representative. The scope of the activities and agreement should be limited to safety only, right? So our focus is only on the safety. Union representatives should be selected from the basis of their safety knowledge, interest and experience, and should be cooperative and sincere. So the union representative, so equal number of union representative workers are there, but the union representative should be selected. All right, it is a management representative. So from the management, from the various members of the management, there is a management representative. Now from the union members, there is a union representative. So on the basis of their knowledge, interest and experience, union representative can be selected. They should not bring other union demands like bargaining, grievance setting, etc. in the meeting of safety committee. In this meeting, only safety related things can be discussed, not other things like this, bargaining and grievances, etc. Union must recognize management right of leadership in a joint safety program. Central Board of Workers Education, Ministry of Labor, Government of India runs many schemes for workers education and training such as. So Central Board also running some programs like tripartite scheme, a worker to work training scheme, voluntary scheme, need based education, education officer training scheme, then workers teacher training program, workers training program, etc. So there are different scheme which is run by this Ministry of Labor, that is Government of India. So we can participate in this scheme also, right? So depending on your requirement, so if you want to train the workers in your organization, then you should go for this worker teachers training program. So training of the trainer first, then you can train the other people also, right? And likewise, need-based education should be adopted from this Ministry of Government. The Central Board of Workers Education, Ministry of Labor, Government of India runs many scheme like this. So we have already discussed this point. Then safety suggestion scheme. This is an old practice to invite safety suggestions for improvement in the process, in the method, in the equipment, in the safety meetings, in the contest, inspection procedure, etc. Suppose if a process is having some hazards, so if you want to suggest that this process should be modified in this way, this process should be adopted in this way, or if the raw material should be replaced by the another raw material, or the parameter of this process should be changed like this. So whatever the suggestions, if it is related to the safety suggestion, then that is nothing but the safety suggestion scheme. So we have to encourage, we have to motivate the workers to take the part in this safety suggestion scheme. Then criticism should be replied in the plant magazine or on the notice board to provoke further suggestions and ideas. So in some of the suggestions, in some of the meetings, in some of the discussions, so criticism may be there, but that criticism should be taken into the positive direction to for the safety awareness programs. So that may be done through the notice boards, that may be through the some online tasks, that may be through some digital displays, and nowadays we are using some e-platform, so that can be done through e-platform also. Then for suggestion scheme to be successful, it is advisable that the employee's effort must be acknowledged even if the suggestion is not adopted. So it should not be case that the suggestions given by that employee is not valid, invalid or anything else. Then that suggestion should be motivated, that suggestions or the employee who is going to suggest this particular activity which is related to the safety should be adopted, should be listened and should be listed out or given in the record, and then you can convince him or her that your suggestion is not feasible technically or it is not feasible economically, whatever it may be. But you have to listen first whatever the suggestions may be given by this workers or the employees. It must be given careful consideration. Good suggestions should be rewarded among others to encourage them to participate. So if any safety suggestion is very good, it can be implemented, it can be executed in your organization. And if that suggestion is really good, then you can give the reward or award or promotions, whatever it may be. So to encourage the other people, to encourage the other workers or employees, you have to give these rewards or awards to that particular employee who has given the good suggestion on the safety. So all these points are covered under this safety suggestion scheme. Then 70, incentive scheme. So some incentives may be given to that employee or to the worker. That may be a financial incentive, that may be a non-financial incentive. But if the suggestions are very good, if the suggestions are valid, if the suggestions are executable or implemented, then you can go through this one of the two types or both types of incentives. So financial reward to the most useful suggestions or activity in safety is the commonest method. Other financial incentives should be also given for suggestion to the solve particular safety problem of plant or process, machine or equipment, etc. Suggestion of good design for a guard or safety device should always be rewarded by handsome amount. So in some of the industries, they are having some practices that you have to design the guard in this shop also, in the premises itself. And if you have designed a good guard, then the reward will be like this. The award will be like this. So whatever the handsome amount is rewarded to that particular employee, that is called as financial incentive. So some promotional activities may be there, some designation change may be there, some scale up may be there, some additional incentives can be given to the employee for suggesting this type of safety solutions. Some non-financial incentives, so award for safety performance, trophy, memento, certificate of merit, public honor, praise or pride, awarding special safety hat or kit or symbol of recognition, awarding special status, duties of safety work, giving special positions such as honorary member of safety committee, raising the cadre or post, giving extra designation for any remarkable safety contribution are all examples of these non-financial incentives. So here there is no involvement of finance, there is no involvement of money, only non-financial incentives can be given to a particular type of suggestions. So these are the different examples where you can understand what exactly the financial incentives are and what are the non-financial incentives are. So these are the safety incentive scheme. Now what exactly the audio-visual publicity? So as we have discussed in the training session also, that if you are involved in a particular activity, then you can absorb, you can learn 90% of that particular activity. So 90% of the contents can be absorbed by that person who is going to see, who is going to listen, who is going to talk, who is going to act accordingly. Then you can understand the awareness of this safety can be enhanced. So a trainee tends to remember 50% what he sees and hears, 70% what he sees and talks. This is possible by audio visual aid only. So what exactly this audio means? Sound or voice. And visual means you are going to see some pictures, photographs, films, etc. So if both, that is sound as well as film or pictures or film is there, then it is called as audio visual facility. And we can use this audio visual aid as a publicity instrument. So to create the awareness among the workers about the safety programs, you can use this audio visual facility. Television and video effectively reproduce actual happening. Therefore, safety education and training by safety films on TV is the most powerful method Only difficulty is in getting safety films or safety videos, cassettes easily or frequently. But nowadays, if you can go through the online platform like Google, YouTube, etc., you can get the different types of safety films. That may be a short film, that may be a particular accident film, that may be a major accident film, etc. So all these things can be absorbed from this online platform. This should be made possible if we wish to utilize its full role in increasing safety. So you can understand this audiovisual facility is nowadays a common method or a publicity instrument to create the awareness about the safety. Slides, film strips, transparencies are easily available or prepared, and therefore they should be used to the extent possible to hold the picture, to discuss the and understand it in details, which is not possible with a moving film. So in some of the cases, slides are required. In some of the cases, some transparencies are required. In some of the cases, film strip is required to show you the particular incident, accident, or the activity step by step, right? In the movie, it is a fast moving or activities are there, but through the slides or the presentation, film strip transparency, you can show or you can reverse again all these things or revert back to that particular point if you don't understand this activity. So these are nothing but the audio visual publicity. Then other promotional methods are safety posters. So safety poster can be prepared, created by your organization. Some safety posters are already available in market. Safety posters are also available with the National Safety Council and the different council or the standard organizations. Then some cartoons are also available for these promotional activities. Then some signs and slogans are also available. You can create these signs and slogans. You can also motivate the workers or the employees by conducting a sign and slogan competition, poster competition, etc., so that you can have a number of signs, slogans, posters from your employees only. Then some publications. So ILO also publishes some of the points regarding the safety, and there are other publications also which are recommended by the national as well as the international bodies. So you can refer these papers which are published in these publications. Then some of the booklets are also available regarding the safety. Then bulletin boards, safety contest, rewards, counseling of education and training, some demonstration, safety meetings, safety campaigns and stunts, first aid training, fire brigades, safety inventory or questionnaires, accident investigation, inspection, job safety analysis, etc., compensated for the encouragements. So these are the different promotional methods which are available. Nowadays, all these methods are easily available due to e-platform, so that you can communicate with a particular organization. You can download some of the contents, some of the papers, some of the posters, etc. So all these activities are now going to become easier due to this e-platform. So these are the different promotional methods to encourage the employees for the safety. Then one point is there, that is called as toolbox talk. A toolbox talk is an informal group discussion that focuses on a particular safety issue. So it is not a formal meeting, it is not a formal discussion, it is not a formal safety committee meeting. It is an informal group discussion and on a particular safety issue. These tools can be used daily to promote departmental safety culture as well as to facilitate the health and safety discussion on job site. So if you observe the construction site nowadays, when the major projects are there, project groups are there, then they are having a toolbox talk is a regular or a daily activity in the morning at 8 o'clock, right? So they are always maintaining this activity on a daily basis to have the safety culture in that or at that construction site. Toolbox stocks are a great safety training tool. If delivered properly, toolbox stocks can be good way to provide timely safety reminders to employees. So that toolbox stock should be delivered properly, then and then only it is effective tool. From staying relevant to storytelling, here are 5 tips to ensure your toolbox stocks are effective. Talk directly to your audience. So you are directly communicated to the audience. Then keep it brief. You have to discuss these things in a short duration, for a short duration. Stay positive, always motivate, always encourage the audience. Demonstrate your point. So whatever you have to discuss, that should be demonstrated in a limited time again. Tell a story, not a statistics. So rather than saying that this is the percentage, this is the graph, this is the bar graph, it is showing like that, you have to make or prepare a story, and you can share that story to that audience, because audience normally listening both the things but remembering the story instead of the statistical data. So this is the concept of toolbox talk. Then what exactly the safety Kaizen is? Kaizen are characterized as short burst of intense activity driven toward resolving a specific problem or achieving a specific company goal in a short period of time. So if you want to achieve a specific problem in a short duration, then we can go for the Kaizens. A typical Kaizen event may last several days with a core team of employees reorganizing and standardizing a work area to create a safer and more efficient working environment, right? So it is a specific activity having specific or expertise persons and with specific duration, that is Kaizen. For example, a Kaizen team implementing 5S. So this is the 5S, which is a Japanese technique, Japanese techniques involving a 5S level housekeeping. So that 5S are nothing but sort, set in order, shine, standardize, sustain. To standardize workplace organization, reduce the number of motions, shorten motion distances, make motions easier, and eliminate tripping hazards and blind spots would also realize improvements in cycle times and overall productivity. So to achieve all these things, you have to go for this 5S. You have to implement or execute this 5S technique, which is Japanese techniques. So for that purpose, that point is, or that goal is called as Kaizen. So this Kaizen word is itself a Japanese word, and now we are calling it as safety Kaizen. Now there is another concept, that is OPL, one point lesson. So one point lesson is a simple yet powerful operational tool used to educate operators in an organization and improve product or service quality. So it is clearly focused on the specific employees, that is operators. So where the operations are going on, so that particular operators are only the target audience in the organizations. To improve what? To improve the productivity, to improve the service quality. So our target is to improve this productivity and service quality, and the audience target is the operators only. So to achieve this task, to achieve this goal with this audience, one point lesson is the better solution. A tool to convey the information, so whatever the information we have, whatever the upgraded information we have, that should be communicated through this OPL to the operators directly. Designed to enhance knowledge and skill in short time, at the right time, whenever needed. So if you are going to change some task, if you are change some sequence, if you are going to change some activity in the operations, then you have to give that particular idea, updation, upgradation to that operators in a short time at the right time. To upgrade levels of exposure by having individual study, learn and then train others in the knowledge or skill. So upgrading the levels of this expertise is the essential thing again in the OPL. So the types of OPL are basic information sheets, problem case study sheet and Kaizen lesson. So what is basic information sheet? Providing practical know-how of components, machines, methods and maintenance. So this is the basic information sheet where clearly indicates that the practical elements are included in that basic information sheet. Then problem case study sheet, educating tackling of an actual problem that had happened in the past. So it is a specific task. Suppose if the accident is happened, that is the finger or the thumb is captured in the conveyor, so that is the accident, and that why it happened, how it happened, how to avoid this type of accident. So that is nothing but the problem case studies. Then this sheet gives us the idea regarding this problem. Then the Kaizen lesson, how productivity and quality can be improved in small continual steps, right? So this is our main target, to improve the product or service quality. So this is can be done with the help of this Kaizen lesson. So these points are referring the practical components, this referring to the actual accident or the actual problem, and this is focusing on the productivity and quality service. So this is one of the example, that is of OPL, safety shoes PPE. Objective is wearing shoes in a proper manner. How to wear the particular safety shoes in a proper manner, that may be a 1 point lesson to that particular operator. So you can observe these two images where improper wearing shoes and proper wearing shoes. So this is the simple task, but it is very important to avoid the accident or incident, and for that purpose you can go through this OPL rather than the different types of training, etc. Then safety competition is also one of the safety participation activity. This is another method of workers participation in safety. Competitions are of two types, individual comparison and group comparison. So individual comparison, where individual worker takes part in the competition and award is given by the comparing individual performance. Examples are safety speech, quiz, essay, poem, slogan writing, posters, cartoons, etc. So all these activities are the individual comparison activities. And in the group comparison, where group take part in the competition and award is given by that particular group. So group versus group, and here individual versus individuals. So in this example, so housekeeping competition for different departments. So that department, one of the department can own that prize. So department includes more than one person, and that is why it is called as group comparison activities. Suppose you have won the prize in the safety essay competition, it is your individual activity, right? So that is why it is individual comparison. Then competition, it is a motivating factor and highly effective in sports and safety. It can be used in work, and it transfers unpleasant work into a game. Competition between equal produces better motivating conditions than competition between unequal in ability. To promote and maintain safety, various types of safety competition should be arranged, like good housekeeping competition, accident-free man-hours work competition, production quantity and quality with safety performance competition, better maintenance of machines, then stores, plant and premises, safety slogans, postures, maxims, essays, awards and various kinds, etc. So there are number of or various examples where you can arrange these types of competitions. It is called as safety competitions. So the participation may be at the individual level, the participation may be at the group level, whatever it may be. But the participation should be encouraged and motivated to all the employees. Then depending on these competitions, so whatever we have discussed up till now, these are the part of the safety participation or the competitions, committees, etc. at the organizational level only. Now we are discussing these safety competitions and awards at national, state and unit level, right? So what are the national awards? workplace safety award by a national safety council. So this is the national level activities conducted by or hosted by the national safety council. So your organizations can participate in that particular workplace safety award competitions. Then occupational excellence achievements award by national safety council again. So this occupational excellent achievement, so it is focusing on the occupational. Then occupational or environmental safety persons of the year by World Safety Organization in India. Now this is the individual persons achievement, but it is recognized at the national level. Then national safety awards by DG Fasli, so it is central government activity and at the national level. Then OSH India awarded by UBM India. Then CIITC Sustainability Award, CII Western Regional Safety Health and Environmental Award, Safety Innovation by Institution of Engineers India. Then Earth Care Awards by JSW and Times of India. Then Golden Peacock Occupational Health and Safety Award at national level. So these are the some of the examples where national competitions can be organized, where the participation of the organization of the workers or the employee from the different organization can take the participate in that national level activity and may own the different national level awards. Then some of the examples of state level awards, that is longest accident free award by National Safety Council Maharashtra chapter. Then Vasundhara Award by Maharashtra Pollution Control Board. Then NEMA Safety Award. Then Green Tech Safety Award from Green Tech Foundation New Delhi. DISH Safety Award, Department of Industrial Safety Health. MPCB is Maharashtra Pollution Control Board. NEMA is the Nasik Industrial Manufacturing Association, but the level of competition is at state level. Then Best Mock Drill by MARC Nashik, so that is Mutual Aid Response Group. So Nasik chapter may organize the state level activity. Largest reduction in accident frequency rate in chemical industries from Punjab Industrial Safety Council Chandigarh. Awards for lowest average accident frequency rate and longest accident free period from Haryana State. Safety and Welfare Award, Safety Award from Punjab Industrial Safety Council. Then Suraksha Puraskar from National Safety Council. Then Karnataka chapter, etc. So Karnataka, Punjab, Maharashtra, Haryana, they are representing the state, and all these activities are at the state level activities. And the unit level activities, so your organization itself, your MIDC itself, or your local level, that may be a taluka place, that may be a village, that may be a city place, so they may organize this type of activities like internal based safety department, accident fire shop award, safety competition, that may be a essay competition, poster competition, slogan competition, etc. Then safety spot award, best fire drill award, intra plant safety excellence award, business excellence safety award, etc. So these are the different competition which can be held at unit level, at state level, at national level. All these activities are or can be organized to motivate the workers or the employees in the safety participation. Okay, thank you. So we have discussed all these things related to the safety participation.